Doesn't the band sound great this morning? I want to share with you one of the formative stories of my life. It's 1993. I'm a junior in high school. It's a Sunday night, and my high school youth group is meeting, as we did every Sunday night in my home church. Our brand new associate minister, the first associate minister in the history of this church, who was called in large part due to the strength of her work with youth, was there meeting with us as she did every Sunday night. Usually our meetings were fun and filled with laughter, but this week we met with a serious purpose. We were going to lay the groundwork for organizing a gay-straight alliance at our high school. Some of us had just come back from a Unitarian Universalist youth conference, attended by youth from dozens and dozens of congregations, where we had attended a workshop led by other youth who had taught their peers about how to start gay-straight alliances in their high schools. We met that Sunday night with serious intention to plan and to organize. We talked about the purpose of this group, how our meetings would be run, who else we should bring in, which teachers we would approach to ask to be sponsors, what was needed to obtain special status or official status as a club, how we would deal with resistance, how we would ensure levels of safety and confidentiality for our peers. We came away that evening with a plan, and we set it into motion. In 1994, we held the first meeting of a gay-straight alliance at our high school. And this was happening not just in the town in which I lived, but all across the state. It had taken off, and in fact, in a few months, plans were made for there to be a great big march of all the gay-straight alliances in the state. May 20th, 1995, the first ever youth pride march in world history. The governor of Massachusetts, let me amend that, the Republican governor of Massachusetts even issued a proclamation declaring May to be Gay Straight Youth Pride Month and declared it's appropriate that all citizens honor and commend the many young people who are working to prevent discrimination and violence against gay and lesbian students throughout the state. And on May 20th, 1995, I was there along with 1,000 teens, more than 1,000 teens throughout the state, as we marched and celebrated. Here's something you may not know. If you looked across the state, you'd see that high schools that successfully launched gay-straight alliances tended to have something in common. What they had in common was that they tended to be located in towns with Unitarian Universalist churches with strong youth groups. And if you looked at towns without gay-straight alliances, high schools without gay-straight alliances, they tended to be in towns without UU churches with strong youth groups. Unitarian Universalist, let me amend that, Unitarian Universalist teenagers played a disproportionate role in the movement to make schools safe for queer youth, to oppose bullying and discrimination and violence, just as a decade later, UU adults would take a disproportionate leadership role in the struggle for marriage equality. This organizing, let me repeat, this organizing was done in 1993, 1994, 95. It mattered. It mattered to young people in those years, and it mattered to the young people who came after them, after us. This work mattered, and this work saved lives. It provided hope and acceptance and safety that made a literal difference between teenagers living and teenagers dying. And it made the experience of being queer or questioning a whole lot safer and less lonely for thousands of young people. It mattered. It really, truly mattered. Let me tell this story a different way. It mattered that there were strong and healthy Unitarian Universalist congregations across the state. It mattered that there were congregations that supported youth groups and recruited youth advisors and hired staff, ministers, and directors of religious education with a passion and an acumen for ministry with young people. It mattered that churches opened their doors for youth conferences. It mattered that the members of these churches funded, generously funded, this ministry. Because without a powerful network of UU youth leaders, this movement, it may have happened, but would have happened a lot more slowly and have been far less effective. How those Unitarian Universalist churches nurtured their young people mattered. Members of UU churches, probably many of them unaware, played a role in saving the lives of teenagers and improving the lives of teenagers, many of whom they'd never meet, who'd never sit in the pews on a Sunday morning or come to youth group on a Sunday night. But this, what they did, mattered. The message of my sermon this morning is rather simple and straightforward. The message is simply this: it matters. What we do as a church matters. Do you believe that? I invite you to turn to your neighbor and tell your neighbor it matters. This morning I want to talk about some of the ways that what we do matters. I want to talk about three ways in particular in which church matters. I'm going to say it matters because we need one another. It matters because how we grow as people matters. And it matters because what we do with our life matters. There's a reading in the hymnal that's one of my favorites. It's by George Odell, and it goes something like this. George Odell writes, "We need one another when we mourn and would be comforted. We need one another when we are in trouble and afraid. We need one another in the hour of success when we look for someone to share our triumphs. And we need one another in the hour of defeat when with encouragement we might endure and stand again. We need one another when we come to die and would have gentle hands prepare us for the journey. All our lives we are in need, and others are in need of us. All our lives we are in need, and others are in need of us. When I look out upon this congregation, the truth of these words is apparent. Because when I look out on any given Sunday morning, what I see is this. I see someone with a new and challenging medical diagnosis. But I also see the person who's traveled that path before saying, "You're not going to travel this path alone. I'm going to be there with you." When I look out on our congregation, I see the person whose family situation is facing a difficult upheaval. And I see the people who surround that person saying, "You can lean on us. Come on and lean on us." When I look out on our congregation, I see the mental health ministry, the caring committee, the spouse loss grief group, the women's group and the men's group, the covenant groups, the choir, the ukulele ensemble, looking after each other. If I ever go to the hospital, I want the ukulele ensemble to come. And bring a casserole. But I see us leaning on each other. We need one another. I'll tell you, as a minister, one of the things that makes me sad, one of the things I struggle to wrap my mind around, are those times when someone who's struggling pulls back from the community out of some sense that they're supposed to, or it's virtuous to struggle or suffer alone. Community works when people turn towards each other. Community matters. The other day, as I was writing this, I had this idea, and it turned out to be a bad idea, and so I don't know why I put it in my sermon. But I kind of wanted to. I was sitting here thinking about the caring that we do for each other. You know, the rides to appointments and meals and visits and befriending and accompanying and all of that. And I had this, I thought, what would it be like to try to put a dollar amount on that? And so I started to do like calculations, which is a silly thing to actually try to calculate the worth of it. How do you do that? But what I got from my kind of loose back of the envelope calculations is that our caring as a congregation to one another, just our caring, if all we did was care for each other, that would be kind of valued at well over $1 million annually as a church. And which is, I don't even know how that makes sense. And I should probably have just X'd this paragraph out. But it actually matters that even if you look at just how we care for one another, that creates somehow more value, more worth, more depth than we can imagine. It matters how we care for one another. And it matters because how we grow as people matters. It's easy to talk about the growth we see in our inspiring young people, how they grow as leaders, how they grow as change makers, how they grow into these just incredibly decent human beings. I think some of us look at our young people and say, "You're the type of person I want to become when I grow up." And we've got these programs that help them. How many people have had a teenager go through OWL? Look at all those hands. And how many of you, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands, how many of you think your teenager came out the other side of that class with more wisdom, maturity, knowledge, and perspective, and as a result, you as a parent thought they were more likely to have better outcomes in life as a result? Look at that. I see hands. I see someone raising two hands out there.
Two teenagers,
two hands. But we never stop growing. I've seen adults grow. I've seen people grow as leaders. I've seen people grow into better listeners. I've seen people grow in their own personal courage, their willingness to put themselves out there. I've seen people's prickly edges be smoothed down through a love found in this community. This congregation matters because how we grow as people matters, how we grow our character, it matters. And this church matters because what we do with our lives matters. When I look out on a Sunday morning, one of the things that I'm amazed by is all the people who I see who are working to make this world a better place. For some of us in the room, it's a professional calling, teaching at an at-risk school, doing cutting-edge scientific research that will improve health, working to counter racial disparities in the courts. I could go on and on and on. And for even more of us, working to make this world a better place is something we do as volunteers, as retirees, or as just kind of the way we are in the world. We serve on nonprofit boards, sign up for shifts at soup kitchens, do ESL tutoring with Latino immigrants, lobby elected officials in Raleigh, and so, so much more. This church matters because it matters what we do with our lives. And so the person who may be working 40, 50, 60 hours a week doing work that makes a difference can come here on Sunday morning and feel rejuvenated, re-inspired, recommitted. The church, for another person, might give us a meaningful platform for service, but it can also act as a recharging station for us, for the lives of consequence that we live out in the world. It matters what we do with our lives, and this church matters because it matters what we do with our lives. This is the time of the year when we think about our commitment to the church. It's the time of the year where we attend cottage meetings, have steward visits, receive pledge packets. And I'm here to tell you this morning that your generosity matters. It matters. Because when the church is well-funded, well-supported, and well-cared for, it makes it possible for all of us to be well-supported and well-cared for. When the church is well-supported, it makes that deep connection possible. That deep connection that is important because we need one another. When the church is well-supported, it abets personal transformation. That personal transformation that is important because it matters how we grow. When the church is well supported, it supports us in our living. And this is important because what we do with our lives matters. There's an old story, an old fable of an older person and a younger person walking on a beach together. And there's been a high tide that has receded, and there are a whole bunch of starfish that have been washed up on the beach. And so the older person and the younger person are walking on the beach, and the young person is running around picking up the starfish and throwing them back. And at one point the older person says, "Well, you can't save all of them." And the young boy picks up one starfish and says, "But it matters. It matters to this one." And so I just want to say, you matter. This church matters. Your generosity matters. Amen. And blessed be. Let's sing again. We're going to sing 118, "This Little Light of Mine." I invite you to rise in body or in spirit as we sing again. Mm-hmm.